I want to welcome you all to the California Historical Society on behalf of my Board of Trustees, my incredible team and staff, our volunteers, all of our members, and all of our guests. Welcome to your House of History for a very special, poignant, and powerful afternoon. We are deeply honored to be a part of our dear friends and partners, actually colluders. I think partnering is overused, and I actually like using colluders because it has a little raciness and intent. At the San Francisco Public Library, you cannot ask for better friends or colluders. And of course, this is a very special part of the One City, One Book extravaganza. Thanking Susan Goldstein, Marcia Snyder, Christina Moretti, and all your colleagues for being so wonderful to work with and allowing us to present this incredible panel today. I want to give a special thanks and remembrance to Jim Jones Jr., who was very hopeful to be with us today. He sends you and especially the panelists all his best, but he was unable to participate due to health reasons, so we'll send out some good love to Jim. The California Historical Society is deeply honored to hold the People's Temple Collection at the decision of the Guyanan and California courts. California Historical Society was chosen as the repository in 1983. We have worked tirelessly with many survivors and many historians and playwrights and students and people passionate to learn what happened and how over those past intervening years. And we are proud to be the largest repository of archival materials relating to the People's Temple and to Jonestown. Whether it be digitization of Super 8 films, or over 50 different collections contained within the People's Temple broader collection, we're honored to steward it, and we invite you all in to research it. We're deeply honored that all of our panelists have taken advantage of this collection, and especially for our members and supporters out there, as well as, of course, for our remarkable archival staff, this is the work that you help us do. Preserving, whether they be FBI files or photographs, some of the last photographs, of course, of many who we lost in Jonestown, your support enables our work. We're also honored to invite you after the program ends back to our library. Over my right-hand shoulder is the North Baker Research Library. Many of you have used it. It's the portal to our remarkable collections. And Jamie Henderson on our staff here has lovingly laid out a number of pieces from the collection, including a number of letters that David used to write his book. So if you haven't seen or touched that part of history, come back afterwards and hold history in your hands. It's even, I think, more powerful. I'm honored to be here today and to moderate the panel. I'm going to introduce my wonderful colleagues up here and get the conversation going, have them talk among themselves, and then take questions from all of you. We're deeply honored that C-SPAN 2 is here today. We always like it when they're here because, you know, we try and look a little better under lights, which means we really can't see you guys that well. So again, you all look beautiful because you're mostly backlit. So to best moderate and also to help the question flow, you will have found little pencils, those beautiful little sharp pencils, there's something so cute about them, and a blank card. So if you have questions, please feel free to jot one down, raise your hand discreetly, like you're bidding, and one of my great team will come and collect them, and then I'll ask them. And what I found in these, for those of you who've been to a panel like that, maybe at the Commonwealth Club or here, is that some of the questions start to kind of lay atop each other, so we can answer a lot of questions, I think, in good time. So I'm going to introduce to your right and to my left, starting with John Cobb. John is one of the few surviving members of the People's Temple who's born into the temple. And his family was part of some of those very first pioneering members who moved out from Indianapolis to Redwood Valley in California. And they were there, of course, for the real beginnings of Reverend Jones' attempts at truly establishing the church. He was a member, of course, until the group's tragic end in 1978, and he was in Georgetown with the basketball team and Jim Jones Jr. at that time. He tragically lost 10 members of his family and in Jonestown, and he is currently writing a book about his story, and we are all wishing him well because the completion date says 2016. Yes, and it shall be. To John's left and your right is, we're thrilled to welcome all these men, and especially Marshall Kilduff, who said he had the best commute ever because he walked from the Chronicle building on 5th and Mission. And for those of you who know Marshall's long and illustrious decades-old career of writing, mostly for the Chronicle, but especially a very powerful piece that was not accepted by the Chronicle in 1978, he has given voice to politics, government, or lack thereof, development, city affairs, and has been one of the really remarkable through lines of the San Francisco Chronicle. As a native of San Francisco and an SI guy, he matriculated from that lovely campus on an old farm in Palo Alto, and joins us today to, I think, add a great depth of narrative. He co-authored Suicide Cult, History of People's Temple, and Jim Jones. Next to Marshall is David Talbot, the man who wrote, of course, Season of the Witch, the one book of the one read of the one city. And there could seem to be no more fitting choice as both the generations fade who actively remember living here and being here in that pretty horrible November of 1978, then David Talbot's book, Season of the Witch, which was published in 2012 and has a deep resonance with us still, and of course is being read widely this week. David is an American journalist that we're honored to call our own here in California, a trailblazer and entrepreneur. He was the founder and former CEO and editor-in-chief of one of the world's first web magazines, Salon.com. You might have heard of it. He figured out the web long before anybody else, to his esteemed credit. And are you wearing your glasses on purpose?
You know, look at you too. It's not a Jim Jones thing, but it's the light. I have sensitive eyes, so forgive me.
No worries.
When we talk later, I'll take my glasses.
Okay. He really has lovely eyes. And turned, of course, an idea into an entire way to consume knowledge with Salon.com. And after leaving Salon, increased his reputation as a historian. Historians like to think of journalists as just faster writers than we are, really. But we're welcoming him into the tribal unit. He's just finished a book called Brothers, on the Kennedy brothers, which I cannot wait to read. And he's also worked as an editor for Mother Jones and writes prolifically for Time, New Yorker, Rolling Stone, and many other publications. Last on the podium, but certainly not least, in terms of big heart and personality and soul, is Eugene Smith. Eugene Smith had just turned 21 years old prior to November 1978. And as he wrote, and I'm going to read his words because they're so beautiful, "For all intent and purposes, Jonestown was the forge that steeled me as well as dictated my immediate future at that time. My only responsibility then was to survive. There was no place to hide or disappear." Eugene lost his mother, his wife, and his infant son that day. And he has, I think, spent the rest of his life dedicated both to remembering and persevering, as he said. His responsibility was to survive and bring us knowledge from the depth of his heart and memory. He turned to writing, and obviously an interesting part of what we'll talk about today is how do you begin to write about this, whether from personal memory or from journalistic or historian's perspective. And Eugene's recent articles include one for the Jonestown Report, and he's at work on a book too. I think 2016 is going to be a big year. fall. Okay, we got spring.
It will
fall.
Be.
It shall be. You've heard it here at the California Historical Society. So please join me in welcoming my four incredible panelists. Thank you. And I think I'm going to just ask David first to provide a brief historical context, as he's done so eloquently. You don't have two chapters of time, dear. Share with us kind of the milieu, the time that, as you so beautifully show us, really starting in after the Summer of Love and the rise of the counterculture, that helps us understand the rise of People's Temple and of Reverend Jones.
Thank you. Yeah, just a quick correction, by the way, because all my books do kind of blur together. But my new book is The Devil's Chessboard, and it's a history of the dark history of the CIA. Is there any other?
As opposed to the light and sunshiny unicorns.
Yes, exactly.
Sorry about that.
The context for People's Temple, I think you really have to look at, frankly, some of what's going on in the city already, the social disruption, the redevelopment that tore out the heart of black San Francisco. And that was the seed bed, the garden for Jim Jones to establish his political roots in this town and begin to have wide influence over the liberal leadership of San Francisco. But I don't think he could have done that if the Fillmore, the Western edition, hadn't first been largely hollowed out by the likes of Justin Herman and the San Francisco Redevelopment Agency, which tore out the heart and soul of what was once known as the Harlem of the West, a very vibrant middle class and lower middle class black community, nightclubs, stores, houses, and so on. My own son, Joe Talbot, working with my honorary son, as I call him, Jimmy Fails, is now making a movie that actually is kind of continuing that legacy, or looking at the legacy of that, the last black man in San Francisco. So to this day, you have a declining African-American population that feels very much sidelined, pushed into the corners in the city, and robbed of its political power. And that definitely was the feeling at the time when Jim Jones came here from Ukiah, Redwood Valley. He was moving into a political vacuum. There were, of course, some African-American churches there, but he became such a powerful force because he was a master at manipulating people. He was a master, and these gentlemen can tell you more about that, about finding out what a politician's weaknesses were, what his turn-ons were, and exploiting them. And of course, he delivered bodies and votes. Vote early, vote often. We can talk about the election of 1975 as a key turning point, the mayor's race, where George Moscone narrowly won election due to voter fraud, I believe, in part. So, but I think, you know, very first and foremost, San Francisco doing soul searching has to analyze what it did to the African American community, allowed that redevelopment or Negro removal, as James Baldwin called it later, to happen. And it was into that vacuum that Jim Jones moved.
Great. Yeah, thank you so much, David. I'm often reminded, as some of you who are my friends know, of that wonderful James Baldwin quote that American history is longer, larger, more beautiful, and more terrible than anything anyone has ever written about it. So in this context of the horrors and of urban renewal, especially as they were played out in San Francisco, targeting first the Japanese American communities who just had come back from being incarcerated at camp, and then simultaneously the African American communities as well, many of whom had moved in during the war, ironically to places held by the Japanese American community. So you have this incredible cycle of displacement, and in comes a man with phenomenal charisma, charm, and power. So I'd like to ask both first John and then Eugene to share firsthand about their experiences and their family's experiences with the church and helping us better understand from their perspectives. So maybe John first.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Welcome. First, my experience is unique in that there are probably, two other people other than myself that were born into people's temple that are still living. So that's what I knew from day one. And all of the things that I've read so far to date, most of the things I'll say, because I haven't read anything by any means, or most of the things we hear or talk about has been factual things. What happened this date, that date, so forth, Jim Jones. And what's been missed is there was a day-to-day occurrence of people's lives and how it functioned within people's temple. Day-to-day what happened, not even Jim Jones, just the people. There were several people that actually made that temple function towards its end. Would have functioned perfectly without Jim Jones, even better. He had much to do with anything towards the end. He was just incapable of doing anything. But there's a whole story that's just, I've repeatedly seen that what happened day to day in People's Temple? What happened day to day in Jonestown? How did people live? Why people were there? What really drove people there? You know, there's a sense of that people were like mindless people following a cult, and it was that not that way at all. Many of the people that I know and people that are still alive today are very successful and did not have a problem integrating back into society because we were not that much different at all. One of the things that it offered, or several things that it offered, you know, a lot of people say it was involved politically and that was a big driving force for it. But I look at the same things happening today. What are the same things that people are voting for and looking for help with? Education, healthcare, housing, being able to put food on your kid's table. Once you became a member of People's Temple, you didn't have to worry about that anymore. You didn't. And your political beliefs, of course, everyone wanted to make the world a better place, but those basic needs were provided for you at some cost, yes. But it's funny, I've talked to a person that I knew that her family was part of People's Temple for quite a while, probably about 20 years, and she has a few kids and grandkids now, and I saw her a couple of years back, and she said, Johnny, boy, I sure wish there was something like People's Temple now. These kids today sure need that structure of purpose. And granted, there was a lot of terrible things that happened, but the reason why people were there day to day and what they accomplished, what they did, the functionality, how they lived day to day, I think has really been missed. And part of the things that has driven me to write is that the people that are no longer with us, you know, their story has never been told. You know, they've died and they've kind of been labeled as people that were a casualty of wrong place, wrong time. Why were you there? And of course, some of the people didn't want to be there. I'll expose a lot of that on my book. Have they had the choice to leave? They would have. But all in all, there was, I think, so much more that was missed to that whole story that's not been told. The negatives, the craziness of Jim Jones and so forth has been repeated endlessly. And I kind of feel that where we are in our culture and our time, people are ready to hear, okay, well, what else happened there? You know, other than the facts and the untimely end of it. And so that's what's driven me to write, and that's where I'm at with it. As far as my story, God, it's long. Like I said, I was born there. And so I had a different understanding of it. I saw it for what it really was behind the scenes. A lot of people came in and saw Jim Jones as a prophet, you name it, I don't know, God, whatever you might call it. I never saw him as that. I never did. A lot of the things that he perpetrated, that he could do, I knew from pretty much day one he wasn't doing those. So I never, it's not why I was there, why my family was there. You know, my mother wanted a better life for her kids. We moved from Indianapolis, you know, against my father's will. He eventually followed us. But so there were other reasons for it. But anyway, basically, that's my story. That's my story. I'm doing a pretty good job of telling, and I think it'll be very interesting. It'll be a lot different than what's out there so far.
Thank you, John. I'd love to come back to some of that, especially those missing stories of the day-to-day community that was formed and the needs that were met. And especially, you're right, in the 70s, when we all kind of hoped.
Exactly.
Believed. Yeah. Actually believe we're all created equal, and crazy time.
Exactly.
Thank you, sir. Eugene.
Well, thanks everybody for being here. I came into the temple basically when I was 15. Ninth grade coming in. I'd always been politically inclined because my mother was. In addition to that, she was always searching for that religion. So in Detroit, we were part of Aretha Franklin's father's church. We were part of Dr. Lofton's church. They had been Catholic. We had been Baptist. We had been Protestant. We had been non-denominational. So every 6 months, it was a new religion. I basically revolted roughly around 12 or 13, so I'm done with it. And she'd heard about Jim Jones, so you really should go hear him. So I went and heard him at Irwin Junior High in Fresno. And I thought it was interesting. The sunglasses threw me off. This isn't a moment, by the way. And I didn't really come back until I was 18. And then I moved directly into a commune in San Francisco at the temple. I stayed behind stage initially. For me, the temple was a candy store in the sense that there were no limits on what I could do. There were no limits on who I could come in contact with. There was no limit to like having, there was no end to my learning. In seventh grade, I was already reading at a 12th grade level. So coming into People's Temple at 18, them having a printing press, having a wood shop, having a construction crew, having all these resources to get you into the community, to meet all these different people, it all seemed normal. And what made it seem so normal was is that you see Moscone at a meeting, or you see Willie Brown at a meeting, or you see Jane Fonda in LA or somewhere. So, well, these people can't be getting, we're not all being fooled. You know, something about this has to be real, or so you assumed. And so what happens after a period of time is that, as John alluded to earlier, is that Jim Jones became background noise. And what you felt responsible for were the other people that were there. They were your family. You felt responsible to them. And a lot of people stayed because they didn't want to leave their family there alone. They didn't want them to be abused or possibly hurt or interrogated because you left. So some people stayed out of guilt. Some people stay out of responsibility. Some people stay out of love for other human beings that they had no blood relationship with, but they felt entitled to protect them, and be at their call, so to speak. And we never called old people. We called them seniors. And they were the repository of knowledge. When a elder person spoke, you were expected to listen. If they needed assistance, you were expected to assist. During that time, they passed on their knowledge to us, and we passed on our knowledge to the younger ones. Jonestown was a little bit different. Getting there was an adventure. Being there was an adventure. And a lot of times, you were working on adrenaline because you'd either had a white knight that you didn't know if it was real or not. And even when you did know it was real, there was a certain urgency to it, just because you were being awakened out of a dead sleep and running to the pavilion to see what had happened. Were we under attack? Were they going to take the children? Were they going to kill the seniors? Were they just going to bomb us off the map and, you know, this never happened? Even if you knew that, there was a certain fright. And my first night coming into Jonestown, we're going through all these potholes. I already wrote about it. And these potholes were just huge because it was just red clay. And you couldn't see the jungle. Even though the jungle is only 20 yards on each side of you, you could not see it. It was so black. You could see what was in front of you. And you could hear the pavilion miles away, people yelling and screaming. You could see the lights of it in the middle of a jungle, because it's right close to Venezuela, which is why we were there. Forest burn of one, that was a disputed area between Venezuela and Guyana. And so by having a religious community there or agricultural mission justified Guyana seizing that particular property. The jumping off that trailer, going to the pavilion, seeing people you hadn't seen for years, or seeing people that you had thought had left, but they hadn't. Seeing my wife, who at that time was just weeks away from delivering. I hadn't seen her probably in 4 months. I hadn't seen my mother in over 2 years. Friends I hadn't seen for longer than that in some cases. So getting there acclimating was easy. Staying there acclimating was very difficult. That's it.
Thank you. Marshall, you started work probably in about 1976, but then intensively, it seems, in about January of 1977, working as a reporter for the Chronicle, investigating People's Temple Church, wanting to write about it for the Chronicle, not accepted by the Chronicle, which David details very closely in terms of how close the Chronicle editorial leadership was to Jim Jones, and then end up publishing, was it 1978 or, March of 77, publishing his piece.
If you're trying to get me fired, you're doing a very good job. So.
Yeah.
let me just...
I will. Anyway, so it's published in New West,
let me try to strike
a
quick note of contrast between these idyllic, idealism-driven, kind of full enclosed life in the church, and the way it would look to you or I, or at least to a reporter, was nothing like that. This church was hostile, very enclosed, didn't want to really deal with the world except on its very own strict and structured terms. It went everywhere on its own. When David mentions the Western tradition being flattened by redevelopment, that's part of the problem, but the church came in as a total unit. They did some recruiting, but they were by and large themselves on buses coming from Redwood Valley. It was not a totally homegrown or very open, really in many ways, organization. It was especially true if you were a reporter asking questions, who's Jones, what are you up to next? Can I look at your temple? Can I walk around and meet your people? It would be very difficult to be a casual joiner or inquirer, or for that matter, a historian like the California Historical Society would want to be. It was a very, very, sort of a circumscribed, bounded world that they lived in. Getting back to the Chronicle, they flattered the heck out of my boss. They invited him. Here's the Western edition. Don't you want to come to our church? We can explain life to you. You know, a new guy in the job would want to know that and be accepted and won over, and he was. So when I went to the church finally after many, many efforts to get there, they sat me in the front row right next to my boss. And they said, and so it was very clear that the temple was in charge of the deal and don't worry about it. But that wasn't so much my problem as the aspects of inside the church that were the troubling part of the whole story, the stuff that David's written about, and I'm sure will be in the books that these two guys are writing about. But that was, your life was really not your own in many, many ways. That broke up families, all your money got turned over. If you're a woman, you were at special disadvantage, put it delicately. There was a lot going on, faith healing to win over folks. It wasn't always as idealistic and as kind of forward-seeking as many of the ideals that you would want to have. And the thing, as this came out, the church basically ran away. They went to Guyana because their time was up in San Francisco. Now, you mentioned the politicians. That's a whole other world. This is a very complex story in a lot of really interesting ways. The politicians saw what they wanted. They took what they wanted. They were pleased. And then when the whole thing fell apart, it was all, I didn't know that. You can't blame me. And David gets in this big time in the book, but it's a whole other side of the story. This absent-mindedness, this lack of history, this forgetfulness, this choosing what you want to remember, to me, is one of the worst parts about this experience. There's no memorials in San Francisco to this thing. When the bodies, remains were brought back from Guyana, those that weren't claimed are now in a kind of corner of an Oakland cemetery. What could be more distant, kind of disembodied, just pulled away from the story than that? A lot of the politicos that you mentioned, Gene, are still hard at it, and who's to say they want to talk about this? I doubt very much. And that there's just a lot of names that have gone through this story that, in my mind, have not really accounted for it, to put it politely. And I think the story, in a way, continues to have kind of fingers into the very, very present. As David said also, San Francisco's in a lot of tumult right now, a different kind. The dates are different. The dollar signs are bigger. The locations, the nature of the quarrel. But, could something like this happen again? Could somebody show up with an answer? Could claims or vows of future good things be taken at face value and never examined? could people be accepted on solely their terms without a real, without any critical look? I think those are, from my mind, as a wise guy journalist, that's kind of what I look for in this story, and what I find is still, the People's Temple itself, the location, the four walls, the property, it's now a U.S. Post Office. I mean, you know, it was a big federal kind of story. The first congressman, the only congressman ever killed in the line of duty was Leo Ryan in Jonestown. Now the federal government owns the land that, in a sense, his bad guy killers came from. So it's cheap irony, maybe that's too simple, but this stuff is buzzing around in many different forms and fashions, and that's my story.
Wow, you have a lot more stories than that. But thank you all four, and I know you're all kind of brimming up here with thoughts and ideas as well as in the audience, and we'll continue our conversation up here a bit more and then turn to you. I am struck as an historian of this remarkable confluence of course, the legacies of slavery, institutional racism, poverty, marginalization, segregation, Jim Crow, coming out, of course, of the powerful, you know, tumultuous time, first with World War I, then World War II, and the dramatic change in demographies that you think of California from about 1948 to 1978. And I always think that time somehow here has a multiplier, right? It's like 2 years California time, you know, no, that's about 20 years somewhere else. Everything seems to happen so fast. And I think the churning social changes that all of you lived through and many of you in the audience lived through and some of us were born into are manifest here on the tip of this peninsula. You know, it's not, David writes very well why someone like Harvey Milk or Moscone coming from a progressive, very progressive tradition, or in Milk's case, you know, fighting tooth and nail for recognition not only as a gay man, but for a role in governance of the city, that all of those took place at that same time, culminating in an opening, I think, really, for someone like Jones to move in. But what I'm loving about the conversation so far is this difference in perspective, that the yearning for community, particularly from dislocated peoples whose lives were continuously ripped apart, to find that, Gina, I was struck by what you said. It was a candy store. You had a library. You had all the things that you'd want as a kid. You had a library, woodshop, printing press. You had health care. You had food. And I think that some of those basic needs, and then, John, what you said in terms of wouldn't it be nice if that kids growing up in the Mission or in really anywhere in the Bay Area outside of pockets of affluence didn't have to worry about that every day. Every minute of every day, or their mamas didn't have to worry about it every minute of every day. So in terms of how the People's Temple encompasses all of those stories, the very personal as well as the very political, is, as I think, some at the heart of what we were hoping to present to all of you today, and you already teed it up so beautifully. John, I'd like to come back to you in terms of some of the missing stories and wanting to reclaim some of that past, that followers weren't necessarily mindless, that they made their own community within that those spaces, whether it was here up in the Redwoods or down in Guyana. Would you talk a little bit more about some of those stories and those people and what you remember and what
Yeah, sure. There's many.
Okay, pick from thousands. Yeah.
There's many. I'll give you an example of a week. For instance, a week in Redwood Valley when I'm probably, let's say, 13 years, 14 years old.
Impressionable time.
Yeah. Not impressionable. I was already there.
I was a member. I mean, as a teenager.
But you have to understand is I saw Jim Jones as. I didn't see him as father, as some people called him. I didn't see him as all these spectacular things. I saw him as a man. We're a family. Both of his son, two of his sons married two of my daughters. We're brothers. We're still brothers to this day. I lived in their house half of the time. I saw him behind the scenes a lot of time. So I wasn't as apprehensive or fearful of him. I talked to him on a daily basis, every other day or so. So, I mean, I was just acclimated to it, to where it was my lifestyle. Very different. A good friend of mine lives in Atlanta. He grew up watching us. He joined the temple when he was, I think, 12 years old. He was a foster kid, came to Redwood Valley, and he said, John, a lot of people thought you guys were treated special, but I was your friend, and you guys were held at such a high regard. And we were talking about our schedule. Monday mornings started off very sleepy, and I'll tell you why in a minute, up in Redwood Valley. Go to school, of course, do our regular things as a student. I was a three-star sports star, so I had practices after school, very busy. After that, on a Monday, come back home, do more work, probably hang out with Jimmy and Steven and us and play a little more ball. Tuesdays, same thing, go to the church, homework, studies with teachers who were members there. Had to do that. I had to keep a 3.0 GPA at a young age, always growing up, and I didn't know why, I just had to. So we were very well educated. A Wednesday night, same thing. We had meetings, temple meetings that lasted, oh God, until late, I don't, whatever. You know, get up, back to school. Thursday, same thing. Thursday, tutoring at school. Friday and Thursday night, games, of course. Friday, games again, school, homework in. Right after our games, we were not really supposed to go to these games all the time, but our parents, along with Marceline, my mother, made sure we all had that experience. Rush after our games, suitcases were packed, get on a bus in Redwood Valley, come to San Francisco. Get to San Francisco after a couple, 2 or 3 hour ride, have a meeting Friday night in San Francisco. After the meeting Friday night in San Francisco, get back on the bus, go to LA. Arrive in LA, do a rest stop overnight, get to LA Saturday morning, we all get off the bus, stay home to our friends in LA that we saw every other week or so, play some basketball, get something to eat, services Saturday, all night Saturday. Stay with friends in LA, services Sunday, all day Sunday, get back on that bus, drop off people in San Francisco, get back to Redwood Valley, what about 3 in the morning, 4 sometimes, sick, rush off to school, everybody goes to work. That was my life. And that's what I knew. And it was normal to me. Surprisingly, it serviced me well as I got older.
Discipline?
Very disciplined, very able to march the task. But it was fun to us because you were not doing it by yourself. You were not doing it being beaten to do it. You were doing it with hundreds of other people your own age. Right. They were your friends. And so everything that you did was fun. It was fun to ride to San Francisco every week. And it was fun to go to LA every week. And it was fun to see all these places. You know, it was what we did. At the same time, it kept us out of trouble. We saw a different lifestyle. Were we being, sometimes people thought we were being programmed and beat down at that same time, not one-on-one per se. He had his indoctrination, he had his meetings or whatnot. I'm sure a lot of people were believing that and listening to it, but we were not there for that reason. We were there for a purpose with our families to ultimately make it a better world, to have other people see the way we lived. We didn't see color, so forth and so forth. And we treated other people that way. We got friends outside of People's Temple that, you know, surprisingly, I'm very good friends with now that were never members. So until I got older, I didn't see what other people were experiencing. Of course, all the other negatives and all the bad things were documented, I'm sure, in David's book. I've not read it, and many of the other books. And that was a part of it. I'm not trying to retell that story. I'm trying to tell a whole different story of just what it was like with life in the temple day to day.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? Well, and People's Temple was one of many communal experiments. Cesar Chavez and La Paz, many people and many historians listening to some of the last tapes of his conversations before his death was increasingly insular. Matt Garcia has written a really brilliant book about this. Increasingly paranoid, increasingly driven to, he had his own white knight version, slightly different. But for so many who went through a lot of the social justice movements in the 60s, their worlds did close in. And what you saw, Marshall, in that kind of fortress, mm-hmm. People's Temple, many people increasingly saw in many movements. And of course, California has an amazing history of communal socialist, other kind of experiments in communal living.
I don't mean to cut you off. No. It being a fortress, I totally agree with what Marshall said. It being a fortress, for a reporter or whatnot, oh, of course. Of course. You weren't privy to a lot of things unless you were a member.
Yeah.
So once you became a member, everything opened up to you. You know, I had friends that went to school once we came to San Francisco that would come on Sundays and visit. Mm-hmm.
But you brought them in.
They would come and visit on their own. They would say, I want to come. I'd say, well, come.
Yeah.
You're welcome to come. It's not
they
like you can't come.
They had you as a conduit, too.
I would see them come in, but I wouldn't hang out with them. I was busy doing other things. I mean, if you wanted to come, you could walk in the door and come. It wasn't like you had to be a member to get in. No. If you wanted to be a reporter and come in and get a story, that's a whole different thing.
Right. Right.
But if you just wanted to walk in off the street, come to a service, you were welcome to come in.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, thank you.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, no, that's very helpful.
Let me ask a question of either John or Eugene, and that is when you see or hear of other religious groups, movements, causes that strike people in an exciting new way, do you kind of wince? Do you worry? Do you think anything of it? Or does it seem not a lesson that you need to learn or talk about? My concern is that so much of this is repeatable and in a way kind of familiar in outline. By talking about it, by writing about it, by speaking as we are today, does that get people a little more aware of their world? Or
I don't know that it does. I think when people have their minds made up to believe in something, they're going to do it regardless. That's just people. That's instinct. You know.
So much for journalism right there.
Well, you know, I don't know. I've seen people that are in other groups and things, and I can look at them and just shake my head, but you can't tell them nothing. They're going to have to go through that and find it out for themselves. You know, I would say that any group for anyone out there that takes any of your rights away, you know, that you can't do this or you can't, when they start saying you can't do this, can't do it, that's flags to go up right there. No. You know, if you don't have the right to go to a traditional type group, church, whether it be whatever, go on Sundays if you want, don't go on Saturdays. Once they start laying down all these rules that you have to abide for, that's no longer a church. You know, you take your rights away. That crosses the line. And that was one of the many problems there. You know.
Eugene, what do you think about Marshall's question?
It's complicated because the temple had a lot of facets. Like John was still in school. I had just graduated from high school when I moved up to to San Francisco. So my day was a lot different. My day was typically started at 5 a.m. By 6 a.m. I was already in the back parking lot and I was on a construction crew. In fact, I was in charge of the construction crew. So in San Francisco, we'd be building crates to send equipment over to Guyana, be it Jonestown or Georgetown. And those crates, if you could imagine the materials for 1,000 people, what had to be packed up, organized, and shipped, it was phenomenal. It took years. When I was on construction in Los Angeles, it was completely different. Day would start probably at 4:30 or 5, we'd be on the job site at 6. What we were doing then is refurbishing homes that had been donated by members. Either we were refurbishing the homes, or we were remodeling the homes, or we were preparing them for sale. And there were literally hundreds of homes. And so the work day would work well until 9, 10, 11 o'clock, and be expected to get up at 5, have your breakfast by 5:30, on the job site by 6. Now, if there was a meeting in San Francisco, we would leave Friday night to be in San Francisco by Saturday morning. We didn't work on Saturday. We didn't work on Sunday. But coming back to get to LA, and we'd leave San Francisco, 9, 10 o'clock on Sunday nights, get back to LA that morning, get directly into your work clothes and go to work, and vice versa. And so it was a very involved environment, a very pushed environment. In terms of people coming freely or coming to meetings, that happened on occasion, but a lot of times they were stopped at the door. And I know this because I was on security at one time as well. And it would be, you know, this is a members night. Wednesday nights were always for members only. And those nights would be different than any other night. Saturday nights were was open services. And people were invited to come and you would be searched. Sometimes a person might be assigned to you to see what you were about, who brought you there, who suggested you come there, who would vouch for you. If no one vouched for you, you just came in cold turkey, so be it. There was always a line that was followed, and it might not be the line that you felt was correct. And sometimes you would let it go because you felt that the end justifies the means. I'm not saying that I agree with that or I think it was right, but that was the moment. The other thing was, is that when new members came, as in myself, and I moved into the temple, I was observed for a long time. In fact, my first day, I was called up to the third floor in San Francisco, and that was where the family stayed. John, you stayed up there, right? Yeah. So I was called up to the third floor. Maria Casares and a couple of, look, Eugene, you're not gonna be running through all these girls. You're not gonna be having all these girlfriends. You're not gonna be doing all of this. You know, you're gonna work for the cause. You're gonna be a socialist. You know, your life has just changed. And sure enough, it did. It did change in a lot of ways. Some things I kept, the majority of it I threw away. What I did keep, though, was perseverance and focus, in that no matter what I do for the remainder of my life, I will always be associated with Jonestown, People's Temple, Jim Jones. My name will always be associated with that. So therefore, the burden for me is to always set an example all the time. There is never an off day. Initially coming back to the U.S. was just horrendous because we were on the news, we were in the paper, we were in magazines, and we're all considered crazies, and that wasn't the case. People's Temple did not attract ignorant people. It just did not.
Yeah. If I could follow up there, and you know, that's my experience from the interviews I've done, and obviously Eugene and John know many, many more people who are involved in the temple than I do, and who I interviewed. But every one of the people I interviewed, actually, who went through People's Temple, were incredibly bright, were incredibly politically sophisticated. It was, you know, for me, very enlightening. Look, I grew up at the same time, you know, and I lived communally. I was very politically active. I was active in the prisoner rights movement when I was in college in Santa Cruz. We were involved in the Soledad Brother movement with George Jackson. I was you know, working with the Black Panthers. I understood that power of working together and having a political vision and wanting to change so much of what was wrong about American society. But as I write in the book, at a certain point, these visionary movements, because we were losing our leaders, not just because of our own fault, leaders were being assassinated, the war in Vietnam kept grinding on, the racial situation in our inner cities was getting worse and worse, there was a poison leaching into America's soul. And that's the way it felt to me as a young person, a young activist at the time. And there was a desperation as we lost one leader after the next, Martin, Bobby, JFK, Malcolm, for new leadership who could step in and take us to the next level. And that was definitely the feeling here when Jim Jones came to San Francisco. A lot of people sized him up as a charlatan right away. And if you read his, you know, I know, John, you were in the inner circle in the family, but as a sort of an observer outside, if you read his correspondence, how at one point he's endorsing Nixon for president in 68, and he's writing fawning letters to Kissinger, and then he does a flip-flop here when he comes to liberal San Francisco, and he's courting liberals as if he's, you know, the second coming of, you know, Bobby Seale. You know, there was a cynicism there that he was practicing. I don't think you, and I don't think most of the people in his movement were cynical. I think you were responding to real needs. And when you two describe what it felt like to be young people in that world, it does feel very warm and embracing. And it's taking care of the basic human needs, as you were saying, that society should be taking care of. And to this day, America hasn't figured that out. And it's in some ways even worse, as we know, with the Black Lives Matter movement, the police violence, and so on. So I totally understand what the attraction was and what it must have felt like for a young person in some ways living in that communal environment that took care of basic needs. But at some point, there was a corruption that set in at the top. Whether Jim was getting into drugs too much, that's what Jim Jr. told me when I talked to him. He saw the drugs becoming a bigger and bigger influence on Jim Sr. And by the time he got here, there was a kind of bubble mentality, I think, that Marshall has referred to, a kind of fortress mentality. You know, I interviewed Cleve Jones, the gay activist who worked closely with Harvey Milk at the time, And Harvey was also cynically using Jim Jones because it was a two-way street for his votes and his support. And he said he would send Cleve over to the People's Temple and say, you know, here, you know, pick up some posters or get something there. He goes, but don't talk to anyone. Be careful. They tape everything you say. At the same time, Harvey Milk was very, and he says they're all crazy, meaning the leadership there. At the same time Harvey Milk is saying that, there's letters right here in the files that I used when I was doing my book of Harvey later when People's Temple went to Guyana, where he's writing to Joe Califano, Jimmy Carter's Secretary of Health, saying, you know, don't cut off the Social Security checks that basically Jim Jones was stealing to fund the operation, because this is a beautiful retirement community. So he knew differently, but the politicians were taking advantage of what Jim Jones could deliver, and Jim Jones was delivering all sorts of things. He was, you know, according to other people I talked to, he was delivering women to, you know, George Moscone. He knew what George Moscone's tastes were in women. And so, again, there was a corruption that was setting in not only within the church, but that corruption began to seep out throughout the liberal leadership in San Francisco, and everyone was implicated. Willie Brown, Dianne Feinstein, you know, right on down the line. Yeah, so I think we have to separate what the dream was, how it did take care of people to a certain extent, but we also have to be honest about the corruption that did set in there at some point.
Definitely, and several people have written it. I'm sure you have in your book. I'm sure you've documented it very well. That has been over and over and over again, you know, and rightfully so, and I don't dispute any of it. He would use whatever platform he needed to get what he wanted. He was a master of that. He could tell you what you wanted to feel and believe and have you believe in it, and he was a master at that. You know, so for sure. You know, and I'm not trying to take away from that. You know, I'm getting older in age, and at one time I was one of the youngest surviving members, and now I'm 55. You know, so we're all getting older, and so I just feel there's a side of this story that people writers and whatnot did not research. Who cares about what happened day to day? What happened from this for the 20 years of it within the organization? How did the people interact? How did that get built? Jim Jones didn't do any of that. Jim Jones didn't pick. His hands were as soft as a baby. Okay, and a lot of spectacular things got accomplished throughout that group. It was very well named People's Temple. You were right. He was heavily dependent upon drugs. You know, I was with him for the last year of his life every day. Me and his sons, we were his personal aides. And he was just drugged out. He was totally gone. Once Jim Jones found out, when his advisors, Charles Gary and others, came from the U.S. to tell him he could never again leave Jonestown, his life was over. He told us. He cried to us and told us. He would plead and beg, be in the radio room at nights. He talked Gene and everyone. And finally it got to the point, he said, Jim, you can't even go to Georgetown anymore. Once you leave Jonestown, you could be arrested. And once that sunk into him, he turned to drugs full time, and he was pretty useless. We pretty much had to hold him when he walked. We had to zip his pants. You know, so in those latter months, he was out of sight sometimes, and when he came to talk, it would be just what in the hell are you talking about? You know, it'd be rhetoric, and he would think of something crazy to talk about, to try to make something when there was nothing to talk about. You have to understand, when he got over there, there was no more need for fake healings. There was no more needs for offerings. He took offerings every hour, seemed like. There was no more need for trips. There was no for a need for him to grandstand. It was time for all hands on deck. We got crops to plant and cattle to herd and houses to build and paint and irrigation that we need. You know, for the first few months, we had no power. The biggest thing that happened over there is when the generator came and we all had power. You know, we all live with wickies at night, walking around with little wickie kerosene candles in the jungle. In the jungle, no lights. I mean, it's like Gene said, you couldn't see your hand. It was so pitch dark. Imagine that. So, I mean, there was a lot going on that he had nothing to do with. See, all these things aren't told. So if all these amazing things are happening, who was doing it? Not him. You know, and those are the things that I'm talking more about. Mm-hmm. Not to take anything negative away from Jim Jones. He was, oh, God, all the bad things that more people have written, true. And then some. I would never take anything from that. But there's also a whole other side of the story of a lot of amazing people that I grew up with and knew for 18 years for my whole life that made that thing transpire. Could have possibly, without Jim Jones, succeeded very well. Some of us discussed that and how to get rid of him in detail, and almost got to that point at one time. Mm-hmm.
And we had to say, no, what will we do if we did this, guys, you know? It got that serious, you know? I mean, thinking ahead, hindsight is 20/20, had that whole thing been able to go on. Even, you know, a lot of people liked staying in Jonestown. Half of the people didn't. My own sister, my eldest sister, told me personally she didn't want to be there anymore. She only stayed because of us, her younger brothers and sisters. And she wanted to she wanted to stay within the organization, but she wanted to be doing it stateside and doing everything, doing other things, as did many people.
May I ask John and Eugene a question that I never was able to figure out when I was doing the research? And this, I hope it's not too traumatic a question, but one of the things I did was listen to the FBI, I guess the FBI got hold of the tape, the final tape.
Right.
Which is chilling, obviously, chills your soul to listen to it, and I still, you know, just shudder thinking about it, what's on that tape. But there's an amazing woman, Christine Miller.
Mm-hmm.
Who stands up to him at one point, and I write about this in the book. And she's the one, at least on the tape that I heard, woman who confronts him and says, no, let's think about the children here. Let's not do what you're about to, you know,
what about Russia?
Tell us to do. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of, and at one point she seems to actually have people coming to her side. She's such a forceful, passionate woman, and her argument is so strong. But then someone stands up and starts to shame her, who turns out to be an ex-boyfriend, someone told me of hers.
Jim McElwain.
Okay, and
Jim McElwain was of the mind of sharing this.
All right,
yeah. So she loses her momentum, and at that point, the power shifts back to Jim Jones. But it's, you know, it's like one of those what ifs that is, again, just, you know, it makes you shudder to think, what if she had been able to persuade the crowd? So my question is, why don't you think more people in that crowd that night did respond to Christine's pleas and say, you know, we've got to, you know, this is madness. We can't go through with this.
It's quite simple.
Okay.
It's very simple, in fact. Any man, young man, that would have stood up, that would have challenged him, that would have supported her, were gone. The basketball team was gone. I was already in Georgetown doing importing. Anybody that would have been any challenge to him publicly were gone. There was no one there to take up the mantle. And just to bring this into perspective, there were meetings before that, you know, in the early summer, like in July, August, as well as March and April, where other members challenged Jones on different things in meetings, you know, there in Jonestown. It just happened that was the last meeting. But anyone that could have challenged him or been able to control him, they were gone.
Do you think he timed it for that reason, because you were all gone?
I don't know so much that he timed it. I know that the timing for Congressman Ryan and that group could not have happened at a worse time. And I don't mean, it should have happened. They should have been allowed access anytime they wanted to, but it happened at a time to, like Eugene is saying, any people that would have stood up to Jim Jones and had people follow him were not there. And we always will carry that for the rest of our lives, and that is so true. Interesting story, Stephanie, my niece, who's doing well, lives in New York. The only reason she's alive is that we were leaving. People left there all the time. You know, for whatever reason, the boat to go on, Eugene worked in town. A lot of people left all the time. People weren't just kept in there like a concentration camp, like many people may have thought or said. But that particular time when we were all leaving, I'd never heard that place that quiet ever in my life. It was, you could hear a pin drop, and everyone stopped working, whether they were in the field or in the carpenter shop or whatever. It's like all 900 people came to just tell us goodbye, and we were happy to be going. We're going to go play basketball, something we were pretty good at and wanted to do, and we're happy, and everybody's looks like they're like ready to cry, and we're like, what's up, you guys? Bye, bye, bye. And my eldest sister, Ava, just came up to me and says, take Stephanie. And I'm like, oh, come on, Ava, we don't want to take, we're going to have fun. She's like, you guys just take her. I feel better her being out here. You guys are gone. Stephanie's alive today because of that. She has a beautiful daughter, our niece, Catherine, who's going to Mills College, who is alive because of that decision. And Ava just it was a feeling there that, wait a minute, because there were one or two of us would leave, some of us would leave for whatever. Jimmy liked to be in town because he preferred being in town. He didn't like being in Jonestown, you know.
In town was Georgetown,
the capital. It was a city as opposed to the jungle, Jonestown. But none of us were, anyone who would have stood up to Jim Jones, that knew Jim Jones, that other people felt safe with, that were close to us,
we were all gone. It was part of that quietness that left.
Do you think people came in to say goodbye to you because they did have a premonition?
No, I don't think it was a premonition. No. I just think they just kind of felt like, oh God, who's going to handle Jim Jones now? You guys are all gone. What the heck? You know, I mean, whoa, hold on a second, because they could see. People just felt more comfortable around all of us, around being there, knowing, and they saw us oppose him. I mean, Stephen argued with him openly several times.
Totally.
And we were like, Stephen, come on, we know you're right, and we'd be the mediators, and people saw that distinction going on. I mean, even when he asked us to come back before it got to that point over the radio, we told him, no, we're having fun, we're doing good, why should we have to come back? Had we known that would happen, we would have gladly gone back. I don't know if anyone's read about this, because like I said, I haven't read a lot of the books, but at the time this all happened, Tim Jones and myself went to the police station and talked to the police chief to see what was going on, and he kept us waiting, and he came in and said, you know, we've heard there's been shots fired. Do you think something could be going on? And we were like, yes, there could be. Get us there right away. Please get us there. Get a helicopter there right away. And he left. We never saw him again. You know, so like I said, Christine stood up. She didn't have enough people to follow her. And a lot of people think that there was mass suicides, murders, whatever. Most people were killed or forced to die. A lot of people had such a devotion to each other, and I don't know how people feel about this. It could be right or wrong, that if your kid was over, a lot of the kids sat together in the nursery or the younger kids sat together, and if one of your kids died, a lot of people aren't going to leave their family there. Right or wrong, they just weren't. So were some people forced to die? Probably, but I think more people that were forced to die did, because once you see your loved one, you're not going to walk away and leave them, and I believe that. At least for my family, I do. I know for a fact one of the people who got away, and she's written a book, I won't mention her name, she was like sisters with my sister, and she told my sister she was leaving. We're getting out of here, we're going into the jungle, and she kissed her and hugged her and said goodbye. I can't leave my family. You know, so.
Yeah. The torture of that. Yeah, Eugene, and then we'll get to some of these great questions, but thank you all.
I want people to understand that when they said they were going to the jungle, understand that this was a triple canopy jungle. In the daytime, it was dark. At night, you could not see your hand. There were howler monkeys, there were poison frogs. Anything that was brightly colored was probably poisonous. It was a plant of some type. There's all kinds of species of ants. Going into that jungle at night, mm-hmm. if you're running there for safety, imagine what you had to be scared of. Yeah. I need y'all to understand that. This jungle was not friendly in the daytime, let alone at night. And if you didn't have a full moon, even when you came into an opening, you couldn't see anything. Please.
Yeah. Darkness. Thank you. Thank you both. And thank all four of you. We have a series of really interesting questions. I'm going to telescope out a little bit, and perhaps for Marshall and David, but as well for John and Eugene. One of our guests wants to know, to what degree did the average San Franciscan know of or experience the People's Temple, and in what ways?
Could you repeat that?
Well,
sure.
If you buy David's book,
yes, and it will be for sale, and he will sign them. Yeah,
that's one of my biggest complaints. Is there's no, and how would it be done appropriately, fairly, honestly, tastefully? And there's no marking of time. There's so little history, consciousness about not just this event, but many like it. I mean, Moscone. There's an awareness that happened, but what would really happen? How did it work out? Today I heard on the radio 35th anniversary of Dan White's suicide.
Today?
I mean, yeah, wow. Today. But moving back to the original reason we're here, I don't, as I said, believe there's much consciousness about something as meaningful as this. I mean, bad news is not something you want to go back over. It's not like the end of World War II. It's not like some happy occasion that marks a dark chapter's end. It's the chapter. It doesn't really have maybe the social lift or the inspiration. But as you can tell, this is a very complex thing. There's so many strands, personal, political, social, what was going on at the time. What do we feel about those times now? It's really an interesting story, and yet I don't know that there's really much awareness.
Yeah, Marshall, though, I think take us back to those years. The average, what did, past tense, the average San Franciscan at the time? So take us to 1977. What do you think they knew?
About
People's Temple and Jim Jones.
I think they were pretty confused. There might be some awareness that the group was a political force, certainly
right.
in in City Hall's kind of wavelength. He was on the Housing Authority. He came to meetings with big troop of people about the same size as this group, I might add. That's about how light he traveled. A couple of buses would pull up. He'd get out. He'd show up. He'd run the meeting. There'd be enormous thunderous clapping for the approval of the minutes. I mean, this guy ran the show. And I think that was at one level. There were news stories towards 77, 78 about his influence, questions about his background. But as David said, people, even his allies, knew there was something off about the guy in terms of how they dealt with him. Milk's example is one. I mean, Milk was a big fan publicly, but before, during, and after, I'm sure he knew better. And there were others, equal-sized names, walking the landscape now, Willie Brown and Jerry Brown, who took part in it all, too, kind of saw the dark side, but went along with it, and I think to their regret.
Is that the Chronicle wasn't doing its job, and Marshall is the best person to testify about that. I write about it in the book. He was trying to do his job as a reporter, and he finally found a way to get that story out. But as we talked about, Steve Gavin, I think his name was the city editor, because he was compromised by Jones, was basically spiking stories. So, the city wasn't getting the proper information it had because people were being compromised, people in politics here and in media. And, today we can have a whole other discussion about, is the city getting all the information it needs? The city's going through its own, great agonies now of eviction and displacement. And I still don't think we have the information loop we need to have in this city. We don't have the political leadership that's really addressing those issues. So there's nothing that, new here. And finally, I wanted to say, there was, though, this sort of radical chic syndrome at the time. I do a lot of speaking around town, and people come up to me and have their own stories to tell, which are always interesting. And a woman came up to me the other night and said, my mom was this kind of crazy liberal, and I loved her, but she was a free spirit, and she took me as a little girl to People's Temple meetings. She was white, a white sort of lefty, San Francisco bohemian type. And I think in those circles, Jim Jones and the People's Temple was seen as really cool. Because it was integrated. It was integrated, and it was progressive, and they had great music, and I'm sure, a lot of the church services were wonderful experiences. So if you weren't a reporter snooping around like Marshall and was getting at the heave-ho, a lot of people felt welcome there and felt that this was part of something like Glide Church today that they wanted to be part of.
Professor of history over at USF, I think his name is Harris, I'm not sure if that's his last name. He did a speech over at UC Berkeley, and he said for back in the 70s, 60s, 70s, if you were black in America, People's Temple was really the best place for you to be, as far as opportunity. I'm sorry, that was you. I'm terrible with names, man, I'm sorry. And I agreed with you. I agreed with you, though. And, as far as the opportunity that it offered. And elaborating on what he said about the political figures, it's funny, Jimmy and I, when we came back in 78, 79, and we bumped into Willie Brown in the Fillmore. And he still knows us. He'd be like, hey, Johnny, hey, Jimmy Jr. And that's all he had to say. We're like, what the fuck? You were there all the time, now this. And then he takes off in his Mercedes and he's gone. We're like, okay, good.
One of the questions, though. He doesn't apologize at all about it. No apologies.
Well, one of the questions from the audience is what more can be done to bring accountability to political figures, like the Brothers Brown, as they like to call themselves, and Feinstein?
One more time?
One of the questions from the audience is what more can be done to bring accountability to political figures like Willie Brown, Jerry Brown, and Dianne Feinstein?
I mean, everybody's heard the word untouchable. I mean, these people have been in these positions for three decades now. It'd be difficult, if not impossible, to make them feel any remorse or responsibility for what they did 30 years ago. And I have to say, any person that thinks the same way they thought 30 years ago is not growing up. So hopefully they're not the same person they were or support the same things they supported 30 years ago. On another thing, though, is that People's Temple did not attract ignorant people. So in terms of finding things on people or compromising politicians or whatever, there were people that came in that joined the temple that knew how to do that. Mm-hmm. You know, this wasn't Jim Jones working in a vacuum all by himself, like the genius mad scientist or anything.
Mm-hmm. Jim Stone.
Yeah, I mean, there were people who were gifted at whatever they were gifted at, and those tools were exploited.
We have four questions on religion that I think I'm going to weave together into one. There's one in particular about the doctrine of People's Temple, and I think that's a big conversation. We could probably spend an hour on that, but I think you've gotten enough of the flavor of its commitment to social justice and providing needs and to having a full kind of community. The socialism aspect, the socialist aspect, was huge. This was a long, kind of continuous, interesting train in which I think Jones picked up, and as well as the leadership in the church, picked up on a very rich tradition, both from the black churches as well as from the progressive churches of the United States, a really kind of post-Second Great Awakening in the 1840s. And it was a really potent stew, I think, a very both kind of spiritual, but also socially very liberal and progressive. But the questions, I think, are interesting. One wants to know kind of how much was religion a part of the daily existence, I think with the weekly existence, obviously. And then others were how the People's Temple experience, so I'm thinking through and then after Jonestown in November of 78, how did it change religion in San Francisco? So I think there's a number of questions about religion. So did it change religion in San Francisco while it was happening and then the aftermath, and then a little bit about kind of religion in the life of the church. Yeah,
I can
Eugene.
Speak to some of that.
Thank you.
It depended on when you joined People's Temple. If you joined in the late 60s, early 70s, it was a religious base. Fundamentalism with healing. If you joined in the 72 to 75, it was a social movement, okay? If you joined between 75 and the end day, it was about getting away from this racist, oppressive system, this capitalism gone wild. So depending when you came in the temple dictated how you responded or what you heard or didn't hear. If you came in with a fundamentalist belief that healers heal and he is the incarnation, that's what you stuck with because that's what drew you. If it was about political causes when you came in, that's what you heard, that's what kept you there. If it was about getting away from the U.S., or getting away from capitalism, moving to a socialist country, that's all you heard, and you dealt with that. You didn't hear any of the other stuff because it was all background noise. That was for other people. You knew why you were there.
Very well answered, Eugene. I think at some point it depended on how once he saw his power grow and how much he could get away with, his indoctrination had changed, and what he spoke about changed. I would hear him at home preparing what he would say day to day, and it would go from talking about religion to social issues, whatnot, to I am God. And once he saw people say yes, he went crazy after that. It changed. It changed fast.
Yeah, I bet. And thank you both. And the periodization, I think, is very powerful. Marshall and David, in terms of how the People's Temple in Jonestown changed the face of religion or the practice of religion and faith in San Francisco. Do you have any thoughts on that? Because David, you chronicle, of course, the demise of the Irish Catholic machine, if you will, early on in the book, and the clashes that brought. But
well, I think one of the interesting things was the relationship between Jim Jones and the other African American pastors and ministers in the area. I think, you know, Eugene and John can probably talk much more informed about this than I am, but I did find out some interesting stories about the tensions between the churches. It seemed to me, on the one hand, you know, the People's Temple was delivering more than the African-American churches that had been there for some time in some ways, you know, in terms of providing social services to the community. So there again, that's one reason why People's Temple was able to sink roots in this wounded community, this hollowed out community, because they were coming through more. There was more energy there. People's Temple was more mobilized politically. There was more a sense that they could do something for you, you know, if you lived in the Fillmore or the Western Addition, I think. And so there was some resentment on the part of other African-American churches and ministers about this upstart who had just moved in. And hey, he's white, you know? I mean, that was weird, wasn't it? I mean, I think for a lot of the African-American religious leadership. And yet some worked out accommodations with him. And so they then became also, I think, compromised later on as well, some of the African-American churches in the community.
You know, that matches what I've turned up to. There was a resentment, a new guy in town, and he did, as I said, bring a lot of his own people, but obviously there was some recruiting, some enlarging of the flock that he needed to do here. And, you know, he would pay bills at other churches. He would flatter them with letters and calls. He would do his best to insinuate himself, at the same time taking 10 or 20 old ladies back to his church when he could. It was a very skillful marketing job, and he was very tough-minded about this. As far as what the explosion of the church, the end game, whatever happened, diminishing the role of religion in San Francisco, boy, that's a big topic. And I would hesitate to play reverend here and say that I knew what long-term effect People's Temple had on religious life in the larger San Francisco. I like to think not a hell of a lot, just because of the kind of downbeat kind of history we're reciting here. But I'm sure it made a lot of people cynical and doubtful about religious leaders for a while.
Eugene, why don't you had your hand up for a bit, and then we're going to give you the last word, and then some questions I didn't get to, I'm sorry, but I know these lovely gentlemen will stay around, and I want, of course, re-welcome you to back to our library to see some of our People's Temple collection, including the letters, some of the toys made from the workshop. The Reverend Jones robe is out, some pretty powerful artifacts. So, Eugene, and then deep thanks all around.
Yeah, in terms of the African-American ministers in the Fillmore and throughout San Francisco in general, I think the issue was this, is that you have a white man coming to town, he's bringing 12 buses, 70 to 100 people per bus, because when we rode on a bus, you sit in all the seats, you sit down the aisle, and there was no luggage up top. All the kids climbed up top. So you had 100 people on those buses at any one time. You got that coming to town, he's getting accommodations that these ministers have asked for forever did not ever get. He's having conversations that they've always wanted and could not get. He's cutting deals that they asked for the same exact deal and couldn't get it. And at the same time, they're having trouble keeping their members because this guy over here, Jim Jones, is not only poaching their members, but he's giving them a reason to leave. Right? And the end play is not only not only did he poach them, not only did he get accommodation, but then he's on the housing commission, which is a powerful position in San Francisco. That's
lot of patronage.
Exactly.
Yeah. Real quickly, real fast. When I came back and I started going to school, going to college, I was kind of like, oh, I don't want to talk about it. I hope nobody recognizes me. So many kids that I met my age, 18, 19 years old, I mean, 50% at least, knew about the church. So, oh my God, my parents wanted me to go there. I mean, in the Bay Area, it was like so many young people knew about it, and their parents wanted them there. It's just that when this man's great article came out, it was just like, and it was a good article, I thank you for that. It was very much needed. But it just, and it was funny when that article came out, I was like, what article? All I heard was your name. Marshall wrote an article, everybody, all kind of hell broke loose. I never saw the article about a year later. I said, oh, this article, you know.
Well, I want to thank all of you in the audience and my four amazing panelists. Delving into these subjects, I think, is the very work that the California Historical Society is honored to do. They're complicated and layered and powerful. There's no one simple, easy answer. But between and among these four amazing souls, I think we've had a really special time. So I want to thank all of you for coming.